Hi, I'm Dimitris Kolonelos, a PhD student at Team Del Software Institute and Universitat Politecnica de Madrid. And this talk is about incrementally aggregatable vector commitments and applications to verifiable decentralized storage. So this is a joint work with Matteo Campanelli from Orhus, Dario Fiore, who is my advisor at Team Del, and Nicola, Greco, and Luca, Nizzardo from Protocol Labs. So let's start first by saying what these vector commitments are. So this is a primitive initially formalized by Catalano and Fiore in 2013 that allows you to commit to a vector of values, so that you can later selectively open any position of this vector, meaning that it allows you to output an opening value for some position together with an opening proof that testifies for the validity of this value. Now, a bit more formally, it consists of four algorithms. One has to do with setup algorithm in order to create a common reference string, a commit algorithm, of course, to create the commitment to the vector, an open algorithm that takes the whole vector and creates an opening proof for a specific position, and finally, a verify algorithm that takes a value for some position together with its corresponding opening proof and outputs one only if this value is indeed the value at this position of the committed vector. So for security, we demand a position binding, which states that nobody should be able to open a position in two different values, meaning that you can uniquely open any position of the vector. And finally, the interesting property of this primitive is succinctness, which states that the commitments and the opening proofs should have size at most polylogarithmic in the size of the vector. So after that, later on 2019, two independent works by Lyon, Malavolta, and Bonnet, Bunes, and Fies introduced a further property of vector commitments, which is called subvector openings. And that is the ability to produce a single opening proof for many positions of the vector. And this for any arbitrary positions of the vector. So this opening proof, should be succinct, meaning that it should have the same size as it would have for a single position, which is what makes this property of subvector openings interesting. Okay, so now regarding related work, we have different constructions from different assumptions about vector commitments with different properties, of course. But the fact is that before our work, the only known vector commitment that can support subvector openings and constant size parameters was the work by Bonnet et al. That is working over groups of unknown order. So I also would like to mention some concurrent works with ours. One is from Tomescu et al. And another one is from Gorbunov et al. That came out this year. And they both are working over pairings. They have linear size parameters because this is until today, something kind of inherent for vector commitments from pairings. And finally, they both support subvector openings. And finally, I also would like to mention another work that is appearing at Asiacrypt 2020 by Agrawal and Raghuraman. And it also supports subvector openings. It has constant size parameters and it is working over groups of unknown order. So regarding applications, I think the most important to my knowledge are have to do with the stateless blockchain. Vector commitments find applications in stateless blockchains, in the PCP and IOP-based zero-knowledge proofs, in keyless proofs of reliability, and finally in decentralized storage networks, which is something that we're going to seeing this talk. Okay, now for our contributions, we again continue the study of vector commitments by first introducing a new notion that is called incremental aggregation, motivated by two applications that we're going to discuss. One has to do with efficiently opening a vector commitment by preprocessing, and another application has to do with decentralized storage. So for that, we formalize a primitive called verifiable decentralized storage. And then in the construction side, we give two incrementally aggregatable vector commitments plus two verifiable decentralized storage primitives based on these vector commitments. So we said we introduce incremental aggregation. Let's see what this property is. So first of all, aggregating proofs simply means to take two proofs for different positions and merge them into one. And this is the difference between this and subvector openings is that now you should be able to do this without knowing the whole vector, meaning that you should only know the proofs and the opening values at these positions that we are aggregating. And of course, finally, the resulting proof should have the same size as the initial ones. It should be succinct. Now, the incremental aggregation property says that you have unbounded aggregation and unbounded disaggregation. And unbounded aggregation means that you can arbitrarily and unbounded times aggregate opening proofs, while unbounded disaggregation is the inverse operation, stating that you can take an aggregated proof and disaggregate it for any arbitrary subset of its positions. And a toy example that explains a bit the usefulness of this property is when we have a network that is cooperating in order to output some positions of the vector. So the first node has one position, it outputs also an opening proof. The second, now the second node has another opening value and which adds in the set of the opening values, but now it also outputs an aggregated proof about these two values, meaning that the second node doesn't have to send two opening proofs about the two values because she is able to aggregate these proofs. And this goes on. The third one also outputs a third value together again with an aggregated opening proof. And this shows that since you are able to aggregate opening proofs, the communication overhead inside this network is optimal, meaning that you always have to send only one extra opening proof. So let's see our first application. We said the first application has to do with efficiently opening with preprocessing. Now the problem of opening a vector commitment is that it inherently takes at least linear time. So in order to compute this opening proof, you should make linearly the size of the vector operations. So in order to overcome this, we propose a method with preprocessing that is based in an offline phase where you precompute aggregated proofs that cover the whole vector. And then at the online phase, you receive a query, you disaggregate your aggregated proofs in order to get distinct proofs for each position of the query. And finally, you aggregate back in order to answer the query. So since we said that this disaggregate and aggregate do not work over the whole vector, do not touch the whole vector, this is much more efficient than actually computing from scratch the answer to the query, the opening proof. So we said that in the offline phase, you have to store aggregated proofs. This means that you have a storage overhead, which is always the cost of having a preprocessing method. So the aggregated proofs are about chunks of some size of the vector. So if the chunk, if this chunks is of size b, then you have a storage overhead, of course, of n over b. But this adds an extra overhead in the online time proportional to this b, because you have to disaggregate at the online phase these aggregated proofs. And this is what we call a b trade-off, which is a trade-off between storage overhead and online time. And this b characterizes this trade-off, is the parameter of this trade-off. So another caveat in the previous method is that, take for example that b equals 1. So in the offline phase, you need to compute all the proofs, one proof for each position of the vector. And that would naively take quadratic time, because you have to compute n proofs that, as we said, take at least linear time. So in order to overcome this, our idea was to, in order to speed up this computation, our idea was to propose a divide-and-conquer algorithm. And that is, first, compute an aggregated proof for all the positions of the vector, which, believe me, it is inherently very efficient to do. It takes constant time. And then disaggregate in a divide-and-conquer fashion in the left half and right half of the, for the left half and right half of the vector. And you continue like that in a divide-and-conquer fashion. And at the end, you get an n log n time instead of a quadratic time. And the interesting part is that this method is generic. We haven't assumed any construction. The only assumption, the only thing that we have assumed is that the vector commitment is incrementally aggregatable in order to have this disaggregation. Okay, so now let's move to our constructions. We have two constructions that are both over groups of unknown order and have both constant size parameters. The first one builds on the BBF vector commitment, while our second builds on the LM19 vector commitment. So now we're going to discuss, we're going to see how our first construction works. So the first builds on BBF. So as a warm-up, let's first see how the BBF vector commitment works. Now imagine that we have a vector of bits, meaning that each position of the vector has value either 0 or 1. First thing that we need to do is to put each position that has value 1 into a set. And this set, we call it informally a set of 1s. And then we are using an object, which is called RSA accumulator, in order to create a small binding digest of this set. And this is a commitment to the set. So RSA accumulators can be used to create commitments to a set. But at the same time, they give you the ability to create membership witnesses for elements in the set or non-membership witnesses for elements outside the set. So now the vector commitment goes like this. The commitment is the output of the RSA accumulator. And then for the opening, we either provide a membership witness if the element is 1, meaning that its position is in the set of 1s, or a non-membership witness if the element is 0. Now, the problem with this BBF vector commitment is that the non-membership witnesses specifically are not incrementally aggregatable. While the membership witnesses are, non-membership witnesses are not. So in order to achieve this incremental aggregation property, we need to get rid of these non-membership witnesses. And for that, if we don't have non-membership witnesses, we are not able to provide proofs, opening proofs for the positions that have 0. So for that, we need to consider another set, to construct another set, the set of zeros, and use another accumulator for the set of zeros. So now we have two accumulated sets, and we provide either a membership witness with respect to the set of ones if the element is 1, or a membership witness with respect to the set of zeros if the element is zero. But this still is not, it does not have position binding, because possibly an attacker can put, for example, an element in both sides. So we need to prevent this. And in order to prevent this, we need to show that the union of the two sets, the set of ones and the set of zeros that are accumulated, is exactly the set of all the positions, meaning that the two sets form a partition of the set of all the positions. So for this, we construct a succinct argument of knowledge, which we call proof of union, that proves exactly this statement. And this concludes our construction. So our construction for the commitment, we have an accumulator, accumulated value for zeros, accumulated value for ones, and the succinct proof of union. And finally, since the openings are only membership witnesses, as we described, we get the incremental aggregation property. Okay, so now for our second incrementally aggregatable vector commitment, we take the LM19 subvector commitment, which unfortunately, as we said, has linear size parameters. So we have to apply some tricks to make the parameters constant. And at the same time, we provided methods for unbounded aggregation and disaggregation. And that is with our constructions. So this is a table of comparison that summarizes somehow the asymptotics of our schemes. We compare with constant sized parameters, vector commitments. Now, some observations on this table is, for example, that as we said, of course, we support incremental aggregation. On the other hand, the BBF supports only one hop aggregation, meaning that you cannot aggregate already aggregated proofs, while Merkle trees do not support incremental aggregation at all. And then this allows us to have this trade-off for the precomputation that we described, while in the BBF this is not possible. And finally, our second vector commitment is the most efficient one comparing to these three vector commitments with subvector openings. And for example, the commitment is one group element, while the opening proof is only two group elements. Okay, so now we move to our second application that has to do with decentralized storage services. So in plain words, the decentralized storage problem is if you have a file that you model as a vector and you want to decentralize its storage. So this means that you want a network of nodes to store the file. So an example application of this is decentralized storage networks, as for example the IPFS project or the Filecoin, and stateless account based cryptocurrencies, where this vector that you are storing is specifically the key value map, and the nodes that are storing the file are specifically the owners of the accounts. In decentralized storage, you have two types of nodes: storage nodes that participate in this storage network, and client nodes that only wish to learn some subfile, some part of the file. So the client node is sending a query to the network. The network should cooperate somehow in order to retrieve the opening values at these specific positions. They send the network sends these values to the client, and then the client should ensure it's wondering whether these values are correct with respect to the file that the network is storing. And this is a problem of decentralized storage. Now, another aspect of the problem is that we should consider updates, otherwise the static case doesn't seem to be very realistic. So we consider three types of updates. One has to do with modification, which is simply modify some positions of the vector. Another has to do with deletion from the end of the file, from the end of the vector. And finally, add at the end of the vector, add new values at the end of the vector. So these storage networks, and there's a general rule for these storage networks that says that every node should pay according to how much it has chosen to store. And this is a very important property for a decentralized storage network, since, for example, the file that the whole network is storing is can be huge, while we don't want to exclude any storage node, even if it doesn't have big computational power or memory, we don't want to exclude this storage node. So in this example, for example, we can have a network that has amazing capabilities in storing in storage, for example, 1 exabyte, while a storage node only wishes to participate with her laptop and only can afford to allocate 100 gigabytes for the network. So we don't want to exclude the storage, and we cannot possibly assume that it can do it can do operations linear in the size of the whole file, or to store something linear in the size of the file. So this is impossible. Now, in order to solve this problem, we propose a primitive called verifiable decentralized storage. And this is a cryptographic primitive dealing with the cryptographic aspects, with cryptographic matters of the problem. So first thing is to add a commitment for this file, which is a commitment for the whole file that the network is storing. This commitment should be stored by any node of the network, even by client nodes. And then also, storage nodes are responsible for creating opening proofs together with the answers of the query. So that is in order for the client to take these opening proofs together with the opening values that are the answers of the query, and verify that indeed these values are valid with respect to the commitment. So this ensures the integrity of the system. Now, the properties that we described about the decentralized storage problem translate into properties of vector commitments. So we said that nobody should store all file linear in the size of the file data. This means that we need constant size parameters. We cannot afford linear size parameters. Then nobody should do linear in the size of the file computations, meaning that we need efficient proof updates and digest updates. We cannot possibly afford to have to compute from scratch either proofs or digests that takes linear in the size of the file time. And finally, since the cryptographic overhead, as we described, should be minimal, we need incrementally aggregatable proofs. And if we take a look of what we have in the literature, if we were to use any vector commitment from the literature, then it lacks some of these properties that are necessary. While our constructions, the vector commitments that we described in the previous slides can satisfy all of these properties. So what we did for the VDS primitive to construct verifiable decentralized storage, to instantiate the verifiable decentralized storage, is to take our vector commitments, put updatable digest, updatable proofs. So we give methods to update digests and proofs efficiently, but this at the cost of lowering the security, meaning that now we need to have weak position binding. We cannot let an adversary compute the digest of the commitment. So our VDS primitive is nothing more and nothing less. Our VDS constructions concretely, it's nothing more and nothing less than actually vector commitments with updatable digest and updatable proofs. So that said, there's a general statement that we can make, which says that any vector commitment with these five properties, constant size parameters, incremental aggregation, updatable digest and proofs, and weak position binding can give a VDS primitive. So that was the final statement. There are more things that can be found in the paper, and these are shown in this slide. So thank you for your attention.